The search for ultimate meaning in the universe. The keys that would unlock reality and humanity's destiny. What does prophecy mean for you? It's not what you thought. It's not what you heard. If you are searching, the answers can be found here in Prophecies Decoded.
Good evening, Errol. Look at, got all these people here, and I know there are lots more that are watching around the world. I'm really excited about that.
Yes, I've had a few responses from people around the world. So we want to say good evening, not just to those in Nashville, but we want to say good evening to everybody wherever you
That's right.
In one of our satellite sites, or perhaps you are watching before the computer, or some are on DirecTV.
Yes.
Wherever you are, welcome to Prophecies Decoded.
That's right. We had a night off, and we are in our final week, some very important messages, and I'm excited about that.
Yes. Where's some of the places people are coming from?
Well, I tell you what, I have two from Michigan, and I know exactly where they're at. I've been there before. Traverse City, Michigan, and Lake Orion, Michigan. They said hello to us, so we're saying hello back to them. What about you?
I have Dobbins in California.
Okay. And I also have St. Paul, Minnesota, the east side. I have a picture, I believe, that is up there of St. Paul, Minnesota, east side. Want to make that clarification? Who else do we have?
I have Morrisontown, New Jersey, and I think we also have a picture.
New Jersey.
Yes,
yeah, there they are. Okay. And also Kingston, Ontario. We have a picture from there also.
We are from Clemens, North Carolina.
North Carolina.
Yes.
Great. We want to say hi. Okay, everybody, here's our wave time.
Let's say hi.
Great welcome. All those hands waving.
While
That's
we're
great.
Waving, I even got a message from, I think it was from Mandeville, Jamaica.
really?
Yeah.
Yay.
So we
that's
have people
great.
All over watching us.
Yes, that's exciting. We want to remind you that you can go to reports at propheciesdecoded.com.
Yes.
And that's where you're going to keep in touch with us.
You can also keep in touch with us through Facebook.
That's right.
You know, and if you like Facebook, if you go to facebook.com/prophecies decoded and you just click like, then all that's happening behind the scene, you get all of that information will come to your Facebook page.
Yes, it's a great place to go.
Yeah.
We want to remind you of response cards, not only at our host site, but also at your satellite site. We want to make sure that you are responding, and I know Dr. Cluze will also have something to say about that.
And I think as we get into this last week, Dr. Cluze certainly values all the response he has been receiving. Want to encourage you, therefore, to continue to respond.
That's right. Now, tonight, we have a very special guest for our health talk. Errol, who's here with us?
We have Dr. Hans Diehl. He's director of Lifestyle Medical Institute at Loma Linda University. And we want to welcome Dr. Diehl. We really appreciate the blessing you will leave with us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Diehl.
It's a real pleasure for me to be here in Nashville. My topic tonight, rational weight management. My offer, an incredible offer, how to eat more and lose weight. For many years, we have been holding our national weight relatively well. And then it began 40 years ago. And now we have wider seats than ever. The chairs had to be widened. And as the chairs had to be widened, we also began to see an epidemic of Western diseases burgeoning in our society, such as diabetes, high blood pressure, heart disease, asthma, and the different kinds of cancers. And people have thought, maybe this is genetics. But this cannot be genetics because it takes about 400 years to change the genetics of a society. This happened in 40 years. So it's not genetics, it's the culture. It's the culture that has seduced us with incredible taste sensations that nobody can resist, and the weight is coming on. Take a look at this particular PowerPoint. You see here that 51% of the calories that we eat in America today come from processed and refined foods. Another 42% come from animal products and from dairy products. And what is left? 7 measly% of all the calories will come from fresh fruits, they will come from vegetables, whole grains, and legumes. Just to give you some idea, in the last 40 years, fast food consumption has increased by 40 times. And French fries are now the most often eaten vegetable in America. And if you have a supersized Coke, fries, and a Big Mac, it takes you 7 hours of walking to burn off those calories. So we find ourselves in a culture that has changed. We find ourselves in a food revolution. There are empty calories that have been emptied of nutrition, such as sugars and visible fats and alcohol. They make up 50% of the calories that we eat today. Take a look. Here are the amount of sugar, 42 teaspoons per person per day on the average in this country. No nutritional value. And people say, that's impossible. Not really, when you realize that the average family buys 56 soft drinks a week, husband, wife, and two children. And when you begin to realize all the goodies that we have there, the German chocolate cakes, the donuts, the banana splits, they're all there. And then you have these cereal candies for our kids. And then begin to realize that it's not just the sugar, it's also what we're doing industrially. We're taking 14 ears of corn and we extract the corn oil, and then we get 1 tablespoon of corn oil out of that, and now we can take the corn oil, we end it up in our potato salad, we don't even realize it. Imagine if you wouldn't have extraction processes, you would have to eat 14 ears of corn in one sitting if you wanted to get the equivalent of 1 tablespoon of corn oil. So this is what food technology does. It concentrates the calories. The package gets smaller, but the calories become larger. It's called caloric density. Here, the food revolution in action. We have replaced our potatoes with potato chips. Now, this is 1,100 calories. You could have eaten 9 potatoes. Or you look at corn chips. Here you have 1,440 calories from corn chips. 1 bag, 9 ounces. You could have eaten more than 20 ears of corn. And when it comes to these milkshakes, 2,000 calories. And there are people praying and hoping that these liquid calories just don't count, but they do count. So it's no wonder that in our society, we are overfed and undernourished. But there's something else that we need to discuss, and that is, you have the processed foods on one hand, and then you have the animal products on the other. Take a look at the dramatic increase in animal consumption patterns in our society. We used to have about 124 pounds. 100 years later now, it's 200 plus pounds. And this is what the average American eats in a lifetime. An average American eats in a lifetime 12 cows, 25 hogs, and 2,400 chickens. And then on top of that, we have now the emergence of an epidemic of excessive cheese. Last 40 years, the cheese consumption has gone up dramatically. And again, cheese is a high-fat food. 70% of the calories in cheese is fat, just like a steak. Here's my point. If you want to lose weight, eat more food, but of the right kind. As you cut back on animal products, as you cut back on processed foods, you have much more room now to eat real food, such as fresh fruits and vegetables and whole grains and legumes. These are the foods that come out of the hand of the master designer. And you can eat all you want to your heart's content, and you will be guaranteed just about to lose 1 to 2 pounds of extra weight a week. And you will be a winner in the losing game by eating more, but the right foods. God bless you.
Yeah.
certainly must thank Dr. Deal for.
I think I have to clean out a
humorously.
Pantry. Yes, yes. But
reminding us.
Powerful message.
Yes.
Right now is our question and answer time, and people
do send questions still to questions@prophecysdecoded.com. We appreciate that. Or text.
Our texting 914-648-7059. So please keep those questions
and
coming.
And this evening we do have questions.
Yes,
so
we do.
Gail, you will take some questions for Dr. Kluze.
Yes.
Hi, Gail. Let me just say, that, by the way, that I'm getting these text questions, and I've gotten quite a few. Tonight is a good example of what's taking place now. A number of the questions already have been answered or have been addressed to in other series, so that's why we're not just repeating that for the sake of those who have already heard the answers, and so we get to be a little bit choosy about that.
Okay.
But keep sending those questions. It might be that we haven't answered them.
This is the first one. This person asks, as Christians, can we celebrate Christmas, Easter, Halloween? What is the biblical stand on
that? Yeah, we talked about how the pagan origin of a lot of these Christian festivals. It is true that Jesus was not born December 21st. That's very clear. He probably was born in September or October based on what we read from Scripture, but we don't have the exact date. And I think that God probably in his wisdom did not give us the exact date, because then we would kind of venerate that day, et cetera, et cetera. However, it's a good opportunity for Christians to say, hey, let's celebrate Jesus. Let's talk about Jesus. A lot of the music is beautiful music that lifts you up. It's a good opportunity to get together with families and think about the Lord Jesus Christ. So I don't think that the fact that it had a pagan origin can minimize our opportunity to honor the Lord Jesus when it is a time that other people also recognize that. Now, Halloween is a different story, because Halloween is not honoring Jesus in any way, shape, or form.
Right. So I can give a Christmas gift, maybe.
Yeah,
that's all right. Okay. This person has a very real concern and a real question. I am struggling not only with understanding the Bible, but I am the main breadwinner in the house with two jobs. My second job is seasonal, November to January, and they want me to work on Saturdays. Due to my main job, it limits when I can work. And the second one. And also, I struggle with having enough faith to tithe when we're in a financial mega struggle. Due to these struggles, I'm afraid I am, as they say, doomed.
Mm. Thank you for asking that question so honestly. The Bible's message is that we can trust God not only in the small things, but we can trust God in the biggest things we can ever face. That God will follow through with his promises. If we, Psalm 37, verse 4 says, trust in the Lord and do good, and he will bring your dreams, your wishes to pass. So God does not want us to starve to death. He does not want us to be irresponsible with our families, but he does say, keep the Sabbath holy. So if he says, keep the Sabbath holy, it is not like, okay, God, you didn't think about the fact that then I wouldn't have a job. Of course he thought about the fact that you wouldn't have a job. He will either provide another job, he will provide some way to work it. The key thing is to step by faith and say, God, I am going to keep the Sabbath holy. Now the issue is in your lap. You will take care of me. How will you do that? I'm looking forward to seeing how that happens.
Thank you. I think we should pray for that person.
Yeah. Right? Yes, absolutely.
Yes. This question comes from Amsterdam, New York. Brian asks, you taught that our sins are kept in the Holy of Holies in heaven till the end, so that there is no question or doubt about redemption from Jesus. Jeremiah 31:34 says, God will remember our sins no more. When will that happen?
God, as far as our justification, our standing with God, God doesn't remember our sins no more, but the devil does. In the great controversy between good and evil, God has to give an answer to anyone who asks. That is the reason why he keeps those records until everything is clear and everybody understands that what God has done for that person is valid, and that person has come to be under the shadow of the Almighty as opposed to being on his own. The devil is very clever. The devil is the one that entices us to go our way And then he gets Jesus' attention and says, look at that person is going his way. You see what I'm saying? So the devil knows that we cannot live without depending on God. But then he is the one that makes us do that. So God in his wisdom says, no, I will have an answer. Here's the record. Here's the evidence that this person has come to me, and the devil has nothing on them either.
Thank you. Joyce asks, please explain the meaning of John 20, 21 to 23, and also Matthew 16 to 19. I believe the former scripture may be the foundation of the Catholic belief that a priest has been given the power by Jesus to forgive sins, and the latter one seems to convey the authority of God on earth to the Pope as one who claims to be the head of the church, as Peter was seen by Jesus.
I wish we had more time to do a little exegesis on those texts, but basically Peter, the word Peter means pebble, and Jesus was doing a play on words. On this rock, he didn't use the same word for Peter, on this rock in reference to himself, shall I build my church? So Jesus' authority is built on, Jesus' church is built on his authority, and as it's as we follow him that we have authority, that the church has authority for anything that God would say.
This is from Warrington, Virginia. This is a whole family, actually, that's asking this question. They've seen the live baptisms, and they've seen that they were done in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And they're asking, they said there's no single instance where people were baptized in any other name than Jesus in the Scriptures. If you happen to believe God is one and his name is Jesus, do you believe baptizing as the apostles did in the name of Jesus? Is it the exact same thing as baptizing in Matthew, what it says in Matthew 28?
It's the exact same thing. Baptizing in the name of Jesus is shorthand for the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, because in Matthew 28, Jesus says, baptize them in the name of, not in the names of. So it is the one name, the name of God.
The three in one.
The same three. The
That's
three
right.
In one. Yeah.
Do you have any others?
No,
not tonight. Okay.
Not tonight.
All
Thank
right.
You.
I think we've concluded that. Thank you, Dr. Cluzet. This evening we have Pastor Alvin Kibble. He is vice president for the Adventist Church all across North America, which includes Canada. And we are just so very grateful that you're going to pray for us tonight. We all need prayer. So thank you.
Let us bow together. Holy God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for your Bible. We thank you for these series of meetings and the opportunity to study your word. We are instructed in your word that the entrance of your word giveth light and understanding. Open our hearts tonight that we might receive your word and that we might respond accordingly to your will. May heaven come down our souls to greet. May glory crown the mercy seat. And may those who are seeking and knocking find the one for whom everything will be made plain. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, and our Redeemer, we pray. Amen.
Thank you so much. This evening, we have a very special guest who's going to bless us with her gift of music. This is Elizabeth Melgard, and she is going to take us to the throne of God through music. Thank you, Elizabeth. And when she concludes, Dr. Cluzet will begin his presentation. Thank you.
Enduring friend, your stand in wonder once again. Your grace still amazes me. Your love, it's still a mystery each day.
Thank you, Lizbeth. What a privilege to have you here this evening. Thank you for joining us wherever you are, whether in one of those 650 satellite places or in your home or wherever you are. Anyway, thank you for being here with us. Tonight we have a very good subject that is going to be very practical for our lives. Just want to remind you that those who are interested in baptism or rebaptism, please contact those that are leading out these sections in these places, and they will help you get ready for that, even to join in as profession of faith as well. Tomorrow night, the subject is the 1,000-year millennium, And then on Wednesday, Revelation's Lake of Fire. We skip a day, and then we come to the last weekend of our gathering together, and that is going to be the subject, the apocalypse, heaven and the apocalypse. And then the last Sabbath seminar that is part of Prophecies Decoded, with the double subjects of a messenger for the last days and Christian standards for today, beginning at 9:30 Central Time, 10:30 Eastern Time. And the last session will be the work of the Holy Spirit in your life. A number of people have been asking me questions about the Holy Spirit, and so we'll be addressing a number of those issues at that time. Tonight's subject is the remnant's use of time, talent, and treasure. Let's begin with this statement. Jesus is coming soon. How many would you agree with that? Amen. Amen. I really believe that Jesus is coming soon, and there are so many evidences of that. I only have about an hour to share every night, and so I really concentrate on what the Bible is sharing. But there is so much extra-biblical collateral data that will support some of the things that we're talking about the Bible, and I wish I could share more of that. But it is really clear that Jesus is coming soon. This can wrap up very quickly. In the meantime, Jesus is gathering a remnant, the people of the time of the end. He's gathering a remnant to help him to be his instrument to share with the world, to be ready for the coming of Jesus. Who are the remnant? Well, we talked about that two nights ago. But in addition to that, let me share this. Revelation 7, verse 2 says, I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. We knew what the seal was, and in the specific context of the Ten Commandments, the seal is what is seen in the fourth commandment, that is the Sabbath commandment. Of course, the seal in its general sense is the character of God, the goodness of God, reflecting what God says, is the laws of God written in the heart, in other words. It continues to say in Revelation 7:2, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was granted to harm the earth and the sea, saying, do not harm the earth, the sea, the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God on their foreheads. And verse 4 says, and I heard the number of them, the number of those who are sealed, and they were 144,000. So here it is. Those who've been asking about the 144,000, we'll talk a little bit about it tonight. The 144,000 are those who are sealed. Who are those? Is that a symbolic number? Is that a literal number? Well, the best way I can understand it, I think it is a symbolic number. Why? In part because the number 12 is the number of the church, 12 tribes, 12 disciples. This 144 is 12 by 12, is a multiple of 12, and the 1,000 was the largest number that biblical people can think of in terms of large numbers. So what we're talking about is probably a great multitude of people that simply are the church of God, which are the church of God in the last days. Now, what does it mean to be sealed? Isaiah 8, verse 16 gives us a clue. Seal the law among my disciples. This is what God wants to seal. It is not a legalistic thing. It is an honoring God thing. It is, that's why he says in Hebrews 8, in the latter days he will want to write his laws in the tablets of our hearts. Like Jesus came to teach, he says the letter of the law is not good. It is the spirit of the law. You need to have the spirit of the law and understand why God is asking you to do that and honor God in that sense. So the person that says, well, I have never broken the sixth commandment that says you shall not murder or you shall not kill. Why? Because I never knifed anybody. I never shot anybody. I never killed anybody. But if you, Matthew 5, if you have hated somebody in your heart, if you have wished somebody to be dead, if you have wanted that somebody to be harmed, you are breaking the sixth commandment. That is the spirit of the law. And that's what the Christian, what God wants the Christian to understand, that God's laws are not just pieces of paper or words that need to be perfunctorily or legalistically followed, but that we need to understand what God, what is behind that. What God desires there then is to seal His law, to seal His character in His disciples. Sealing is also associated with baptism. I don't know if you knew that. Christ writes His law, His character in our hearts. And Ephesians tells us about that, Ephesians 1, 13. In Him you also trusted. This is in reference to the Ephesians when they came to the Lord Jesus Christ. After you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. So those who come to faith, you know, we witnessed several who were baptized a few days ago. They have sealed their promise, their conviction, their decision with Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit has sealed them for the day of redemption. That's what He says in chapter 4, verse 30. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. So the sealing has to do with the seventh day Sabbath, which is a mark of his allegiance to God. The sealing has to do with the character of God in our lives. The sealing has to do with a total commitment in the work of the Holy Spirit upon those who are being sealed. And that is what's happening to the 144,000 before the Lord Jesus Christ comes. These are the remnant. The 144,000 that are sealed are the remnant. Not literal number, but a symbolic number. I think that this involves millions and millions of people in the last days. Now, Revelation 14 picks up the issue of the 144,000, and we read, I looked, and behold, verse 1, a lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his Father's name written on their foreheads. Remember what their seal is, the seal of God? We talked about it last Friday night. The seal of God is on the forehead, right? Well, that is where the name of the Father is also there. It represents our choices, our conscious choice to follow God. In verse 4 we read, these are they that were not defiled with women. Now this is not talking about remaining celibate or anything of that nature. This is symbolic language, just like Babylon was a whore that had gone after other gods. This is in reference to the same type of analogies. Those who have not been defiled with women means they have been faithful to Jesus Christ, as opposed to going after other doctrines, pagan doctrines or doctrines, and, you know, non-biblical doctrines. And then it says, these are the ones who follow the Lamb wherever He goes. So they have a clear commitment. They say, I want to follow Jesus, and that is what I'm going to do, and He is going to lead me. That's an interesting analogy, because sheep get lost very easily. And yet we are following a lamb. Huh? We're following a lamb. But that lamb is Jesus Christ. That's the only sheep that doesn't get lost. In verse 5 we read, in their mouth was found no deceit, for they are without fault before the throne of God. Now that doesn't mean that people were perfect. Sometimes people misinterpret that and says, well, these Christians at the end, they must be perfect. No, they perfectly follow Jesus. In other words, they perfectly trust Jesus. They give their whole 100% to that. Oh, they fall and they make mistakes and they're very imperfect, but they have one direction. They're going in one direction, not many directions, not all over the rest, not going around, not hesitating. They're following the Lamb wherever He goes. Later in that same chapter, after the three angels' messages are announced, then we find those sealed people again. And it makes a comment about them. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus Christ. So they follow Jesus. They trust in Jesus. They keep his commandments. In chapter 12, we find a similar picture. The dragon was enraged with a woman, and he went to make war with the rest of her offspring. In many versions, that says the remnant of her seed. That's exactly the same. So that refers to the remnant who do what? They keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus. You see how that keeps coming back in the book of Revelation. People say, well, I thought the commandment, it makes me uncomfortable to think that I need to keep the commandments. You don't need to be uncomfortable. You just need to be faithful. You need to say, Jesus, whatever you say, I want to keep your commandments. Now, that doesn't mean that you have the power to keep the commandments. One thing is willpower, the other one is the choice or will. We are not asked to exercise willpower. We're asked to exercise the will. Because then, if that were the case, the people who have more willpower would be the super Christians. No, the people that have more willpower tend to be more legalistic, actually. The people that choose God, they're the ones that are victorious. They're the ones that are overcomers. They make a conscious choice. Says, Lord, I want to yield myself to you. Then the power comes from God to work these things out according to his will. So what happens while we wait? What happens while the remnant is here? God is gathering that remnant from every tribe, people, and nation of the world. What is happening while we wait? Revelation 14:7 says, fear God, give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. In other words, there's not a lot of time left here. Worship him who made the heaven and earth and sea and the springs of water. In Revelation chapter 12, we're told, therefore I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your worship, your spiritual act of worship. Living, don't wait until you have a foot in the grave before you give yourself completely to God. Give yourself to God as a living sacrifice. This is what needs to take place in our lives. So let's look at three basic issues in our lives and what the Bible may say about how to deal with those issues in our lives. What about the remnant's use of time? Well, we can say a lot of things about time. Time is the greatest gift that we have from God, and we probably have to give an account of our time. And I am one who is painfully aware of many times when I have wasted my time. That is not the way to honor God, you know. In the book of Romans, we read Paul saying, Romans 15:4, for whatever things were written before were written for our learning, that we through the patience and comfort of the Scriptures might have hope. So what the Bible is, the Bible is given to us so that we can be instructed and so that we can have hope, both reasons. That is why we go to the Scriptures for that, right? That's why we want to study the Word of God, because we know God through the study of the Word. And we get together, this is exactly what you're doing. Night after night, you're gathering together to study the Word of God. And maybe at home, you do that with your spouse. And if you have a young family, you may do that with a young family. It's a very good idea to do that with kids or maybe in the morning, maybe in the evening, or maybe even both, and to spend just a few minutes with the Word of God. So people develop a habit to turn to God all the time. The Word of God is key. The personal study of Scripture is very important. What you are experiencing because of these meetings is very important, but that is not enough. You need to study on your own. You need to wake up in the morning. You need to take time just by yourself. You need to go to that favorite chair of yours. You need to turn that light on. You need to read, and you need to pray, and you need to read again, and then you need to pray, and then you need to read again. Here's a better thing. It's better to read one chapter three times than to read three chapters one time. Why? Because you are chewing the Word of God. The Word of God is like bread that needs to be chewed. The better you chew it, the better you'll digest it. And there is, naturally speaking, many times we read things and it goes right by us. That's why sometimes we're surprised about the things we hear. It says, well, it was right there and I never knew it. Because we're not really paying that much attention to that. We need to think through that and spend time with the Word of God. Romans 10 gives us a great promise. Verse 17, so then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Think about that. In other words, what are we talking about? Do you want to have faith? If you want to have faith, you go to the Bible. The more you go to the Bible, faith is engendered within you. You have a desire to trust God. You desire to put Him first. You naturally do that. Many years ago, before the days of CDs and DVDs, I used to listen to the Word of God in cassette tapes. And I used to go running and listen to the Word of God. And I did that, and I put it in my cassette player in the car when I went to work. And I would listen to 12, 13, 15 chapters every day. I didn't even stop it many times, you know, sometimes I would, but I would just listen, let it just wash over my head. That's besides actually reading the Word of God. I discovered it was a great surprise to me to see how it empowered me to actually trust God. It, you know, by the first time I read it, I went through that. By the time I got to First Judges, I said, First Judges 17, I said, God is something else. He's been so faithful. He's so good. He's so honorable. And my trust in God had increased more and more. Just a few chapters a day, it would take me 3 months to listen to the entire Bible from Genesis 1 to Revelation 22, and I would begin all over again and do that 4 times a year. So I went through the Bible from cover to cover 4 times every year. That is listening to that. And it did exactly what Romans 10, 17 says. As I heard the Word of God, as I heard God speaking through His Word, it gave me trust, faith, confidence in God. That's what the Word of God will do. Jesus spent some time with His friends, Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. And it's a well-known story that when they were having a get-together, Martha, as a good hostess that she was busy preparing food and dishes and taking care of people. But her sister, who had quite a story, a sordid story, she had come to Jesus not long before, and she couldn't get enough of Him. And she did the unseemly thing to do, because in those days, women were not included among disciples. There were no such a thing. Disciples were only a male thing. And women were property of men, actually, the most important property, but that's how it was viewed. But this woman, Mary, she sat at Jesus' feet, just like, you know, with all the other men, just listening to Jesus. What, you know, it must have stood out right out there. And Martha, you know, says, Lord, why don't you tell her to help me? I mean, look at what she's doing. She's in the wrong place. Right, you know, this is not good. And she probably, when you really analyze that carefully, she probably wished she would do that too. And Jesus answers saying, Martha, Martha, you were worried and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed. He plays with words there. It can be translated, one dish is needed. One thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part which will not be taken away from her. In other words, he vouched for her and said, Martha, you're doing some very excellent things, but let me tell you, what your sister's doing is even more important, even though it's countercultural. You recognize this group of people? I do. They are my family, my wife, and our 3 kids, Christopher, Alex, and Stephanie. When they were little and we were younger, they're less than 2 years apart, each of them, from each other. And so Christopher was 4, the dirty blonde with a beard, he was 4, and then Alex was 2, and then the little girl was 2 months old. Now, I was a very busy pastor in a very growing church in California, And my wife, you can imagine how busy she was. We have different temperaments. We have different just about everything. That's why she's so good. And I, you know, with 7 hours of sleep, I do well. She needs a little bit more of her beauty sleep, you know. I have a light sleep. You know, I'm very easily woken up. She, you know, a train can go right by her, and she says, "That's fine," you know. God bless her. Well, one night, she was very tired. But I was going through some very stressful times. A good woman that she is, a good Christian that she is, she asked Jesus to wake her up in the morning because she was afraid she was not going to wake up. She was so tired that she was not going to wake up early enough. She wanted to pray for me in a very special way because of what we were going through. And she says, "Jesus, do whatever is necessary for me to wake up." Now, when you say that to Jesus, when you say, "Do whatever is necessary," you can imagine him smiling out there and looking at the angels and saying, "Did you hear that? I have a big, big green light." Oh, boy, you know, she's up for a surprise, sure enough. 4:30 the next morning, the phone begins to ring. Now, this phone, this is a number of years ago, so that phone was that old clunker thing, you know, it's like 2 tons. You know, remember anybody? You know, no cell phones in those days. Next to my side of the bed, because, of course, if anybody would call late at night, it would be for the pastor, right? And I had developed such an ear about that that you could hear, I could hear the little click. There's a little click before the first ring. And I would grab the phone before the first ring out of a dead sleep. I would answer, you know, and the person would say, "Oh, Pastor, is that you?" "Yes, brother." And he said, "Oh, I didn't hear it ring." Yeah, that's the point, brother. Because I would be, you know, like one of those cats, you know what, sometimes, have you seen the cat when the cat is surprised and it's, you know, it's boom, like this? Well, that would be me with that phone ringing. But that morning, that phone rang at 4:30, right next to my ear. And I'm dead. I'm, you know, there is no sign of life. After 4 rings, the machine, the voice machine, you know, it's supposed to pick it up. Nothing happened. It must have rang, I don't know how many times, for my wife to actually wake up. But she is in one of those dreamy states, you know. There are some people have extremely talented. I cannot go to the bathroom unless I'm actually awake. Some people can do both. So she doesn't quite want to wake up, right? But the phone is ringing. She must have thought, "My husband is dead. He's dead. He's not waking up. Look at that thing ringing off the hook." And so instead of getting out of bed, going around to pick up the phone, she goes and lunges herself right across me, on top of me, to grab the phone. And I'm still not waking up. You know I'm dead, you know. You know, she must have thought, "This man is dead." But she picks up the phone, and she said, the sweetest voice that I have ever heard said to me, "Lisa, are you awake yet?" No dial tone, no sound of any normal phone sound after that. To this day, she's convinced that maybe the Lord used her own angel to really get her awake. And I still have today some of the things that she wrote to me those days, promises from Scripture that were so helpful to me. She said, "God, do whatever is necessary." And God said, "I will. I will." And you know what? God takes you seriously if you take him seriously. And if you want to get up in the morning, this is a promise you can make to it. Isaiah chapter 50, verse 4 says, "He awakens me morning by morning. He awakens my ear to hear as the Lord did not need an alarm clock." The Father woke him up just when he needed. In verse 5, it says, "Nor did I turn away." That's it. If your attitude is saying, God, I want to know you, I want to trust you, I want to fall in love with you all the more, then God says, I am with you. Oh, yeah, but if you give him freedom, sometimes he might wake you up at 2 o'clock in the morning. You can't complain. Can't complain. You can go back to sleep maybe after an hour or two. That's what happens to me many times. But I haven't used an alarm clock in a very, very, very long time, many, many, many years. Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1 is a very fascinating story of Jesus when he was in Galilee after having spent a year and a half in Judea with minimal results. He moves to Galilee and multitudes come. They swarm to Jesus. He's healing people. He's teaching multitudes, thousands at a time. He's casting out demons. That day, he is teaching in the synagogue, and a man is demon-possessed, comes to the front. He casts out that demon, and then he keeps teaching to this great multitude. They go from the synagogue to Peter's house, and his mother-in-law is sick. He heals her. And then as soon as sunset is there, the entire city, the Bible says, the entire city brings all their sick. So he's healing people until who knows what time. This is in the spring, so sunset in the spring is maybe 6:30. Jesus may have been healing people until way past midnight. Now, after that busy day, what would you say to your spouse? Don't wake me up tomorrow, you know, let me sleep in. But not Jesus. You find that Jesus instead cannot be found in the morning. Before sunrise, the disciples go out there because people are already gathering. They can't get enough of Jesus. But they can't find him. And the Bible says in Mark chapter 1, verse 35, now in the morning, having risen a long while before daylight, he went out and departed to a solitary place, and there he prayed. That was the habit of Jesus every single day, to get new, fresh directions from his Father every day. And that gives us a formula. In the morning, a quiet place, focusing on God through the study of the Word and prayer. That is what we need to do for our daily experience. Now, that's our daily time with God. What about our weekly time with God? Hebrews 4:4, written 30 years after Jesus was on this earth. This is a New Testament statement. For he has spoken in a certain place of the seventh day in this way. And God rested on the seventh day from all his works. That's a reference to what? To the commandment, right? To the commandment, Exodus 20. There remains, verse 9 says, there remains therefore a rest for the people of God. There remains, does it say there is abolished there? No, it doesn't, right? It says there remains therefore a rest for the people of God. For the Jews? No, for the people of God, Jew or Gentile, right? For he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works as God did from his. Let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience. What was he talking about? Obviously, he was talking about the fourth commandment. He was talking about the Sabbath, the seventh day Sabbath, which is holy to the Lord. And that is our sacred time during the week. God rested on the seventh day. He also blessed the seventh day, and he sanctified it. The Sabbath rest is a memorial of his creation and of the Creator. And I keep bringing that back simply because so many sincere, good, honest Christians have not known this. And God said, remember, it is time to remember that which we have forgotten. Mark 2:27 says, the Sabbath was made for man, but not men for the Sabbath. And he instructed that in the people of Israel. And that's why when the people of Israel were gathering food every day, God rained that manna from heaven, and every morning they had to gather that. But on Friday, the day before Sabbath, they were to gather two portions for 2 days. And a miracle took place every time the manna fell, but a second miracle took place every Friday, because the next morning, that manna was fresh as opposed to being spoiled. Why? Because God wanted to say, God, I want you to treat this day totally different. differently than everything else. Everything that you do during the week, I want you to do differently this day. I want you to honor me in this day. I want you to separate this. That's what sanctify means. Separate this day from all the others. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. In 6 days, the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it or sanctified it. In Ezekiel was a prophet of in the time of Babylon, when the people of Israel had apostatized already and they had gone after other gods, so they were taken to Babylon. God had a prophet in Babylon to help them, to remind them again. In Ezekiel 20:20, we read, "Hallow my Sabbaths, and they will be a sign between me and you, that you may know that I am the Lord your God." That is the purpose of the Sabbath, to honor God with all our hearts. To 6 days, God says, 6 days you have to do everything else. On this one, look to me in a very special way. That is what the followers of Jesus Christ will do. Isaiah 66 says, "As the new heavens and the new earth which I will make shall remain before me, says the Lord, so shall your descendants and your name remain. It shall come to pass that from a new moon to another and from one Sabbath to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, says the Lord." So can you imagine? Thousands and thousands and thousands of the redeemed. I believe that God has created beings all over the universe, all of them, all of the angels, everyone coming to worship and honor God on the Sabbath day. That is perennial. That will be always this way. That's the use of our time. What about the use of our talents? What about the use of our talents? Revelation 14:7 says, "Fear God, give glory to him." What does that mean? To give glory to God. 1 Corinthians 10:31 says, "Therefore, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God." So our activity, our choices, our priorities are to be in such a way that they honor God. They reflect what God is doing. Take your Bibles and open them to Matthew chapter 25. Let's read the parable of the talents, which is interesting because in English the word talent means gift, ability, but in the Bible the word talent also meant a sum of money that was a currency. It was called a talent. It was a bag of money. It was a weight, actually. And you read that parable from verses 14 to 29. This is page 1286 in your study Bible. And you find that Jesus tells the story of an owner who gives a bag, a talent, actually gives five of them to one person and says, "Work this money and see if you invest it, how much you're going to give back to me." Then he gives to the second one two talents and see what he would do. And then to another one talent and see what you will do. Comes back a year later and checks on his money. Now, this is important. This is not the servant's money. These are not the servant's talents. These are the owner's talents, right? That they're supposed to work for him. And when they return, the first two return, and they come back. The one that had five comes back with 10. The one that had two comes back with 4. And he says to them, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things." That's the way God works. The more talents we have, the more we exercise our talents, let me put it that way, the more we exercise our talents, whether it is our education, our abilities, our time, etc., our connections, the more we exercise our talents, the more God gives us more opportunities to exercise them. So whenever somebody says, "Well, I'm not very talented, I can't preach, I can't sing, I can't teach, I can't do," there is something you can do for God's glory. And if you do that something for God's glory, then God will give you the opportunity to do even more, to expand your influence in that respect. And then he said to them, "Enter into the joy of your Lord." Now, what is that? The joy of the Lord, in Luke 15, we find that There is more joy in heaven for one person who repents than 99 that need no repentance. The joy of the Lord is an expression in Jesus' conversation that means the joy of bringing people to God. Bringing people to God. That is the joy of the Lord. And you will enter into that joy the more you put to work your talents, whatever God has given you, on behalf of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why he said to those disciples, most of whom were fishermen, I will make you fishers of men. That's what he said. In other words, you know how to fish. I'm telling you, I'm gonna put you to work in the real work, that is to bring people to me, to spread that net and bring people to me. That is the joy of the Lord. Now, how about the body of Christ? In 1 Corinthians, we're told about how the body of Christ, the talents of the people of God are to be used. Turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Let's look at that briefly. Verse 12, for instance, this is page 1507 in your study Bible. As the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, etc., etc. In verse 14, for in fact the body is not one member, but many. Right? If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I'm not of the body, it is therefore not part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I'm not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole were hearing, where would the smelling? But now, verse 18, very important, now God has set the members, each one of them in the body, just as he pleased. So don't worry about seemingly less talents than somebody else in the church, in the body of Christ may have. God has put you there with that group of talents and abilities for you to shine right there in that spot. There's something for you to do for his glory there. And the body is many members. It's not one super talented person. It is many persons yielding to God in giving of their time and in talents to the Lord Jesus for him to use you. Now, what about the remnant's use of treasure? The remnant's use of treasure. Well, the Bible makes this very clear. Psalm 24, verse 1 says, the earth is the Lord's. In all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein. So how much belongs to God? Everything. The whole world, everybody who lives in it. That means I belong to him and you belong to him too. And if we belong to him, the things that we possess belong to him too, right? Yeah, that is exactly right. In fact, I find this text really typical of God humor. This is what I call divine humor. Psalm 50, verse 10, for every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle on 1,000 hills. If I were hungry, God says, I would not tell you, for the world is mine in all its fullness. In other words, if I'm hungry, I take anything I want because it's mine. I wouldn't have to beg. I wouldn't have to ask anybody. It all belongs to me. Now, that is a very important premise to begin with. That means that what I have, this suit I'm wearing tonight, this voice I'm using tonight, this health that I have tonight, the car I drive, the home I own, all of it belongs to God. My family belongs to God. If I start from that premise, I am a thankful individual, because that means all of this I'm borrowing. I'm borrowing the suit, I'm borrowing the car, I'm borrowing the house, I'm borrowing my family. God gives them to me he puts me in charge of overseeing that which belongs to him. Psalm 33, verse 6 says, by the word of the Lord the heavens were made, and all that host of them by the breath of his mouth, for he spoke, and it was done. He commanded, it stood fast. God's ability to make something out of nothing is absolute. The theologians call it ex nihilo, out of nothing. He can create with his word, he can make things out of nothing. So that means that a house that I have, you know, for most Americans, their home, if they own that home, is probably the most valuable thing that they have. And sometimes you put some money into remodeling that home or adding to it and so forth. And you really treasure that. You make that home your own and you say, this is, you know, this is just like I like it now. But the truth of the matter is that that can go up in smoke, can it? It can go up in smoke in a jiffy. Just overnight, it can, and there's nothing you can do about it. All of the things we have are not permanent. They're not secure. Luke 12 tells this story. Jesus tells the parable of a man who was making a lot of money. He had good seasons. He was making a lot of, you know, crops, and he was storing them in his barn and just being a good time. And he said to himself, I will say to my soul, soul, you have made many goods laid up for many years. Take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. In other words, he's talking to himself. Let's party. I got so much money, I could live on this for several lifetimes. And the Bible says, next verse, but God said to him, fool, this very night your soul will be required of you. Then whose will those things be which you have provided? All that can go up in smoke. We can't take anything with us. We cannot, this doesn't belong to us. We are in stewardship. We are stewards of what God has. Of what we have. And it behooves us to realize that, because then we can administer that better. Here's what happens. If I have the notion that this car is mine, it doesn't belong to God, that this vehicle is mine, eventually God may actually let me experience what that would be like. And what that means is that maybe that car will break down a lot. I have a collision. All kinds of things may happen. Whereas if it is his, he may allow that car to go. I have known people who are very faithful who have little rickety things, and they're living forever. Is God sustaining that? You know, this is what he's provided for them. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18 says, and you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you power to get wealth. In other words, if I didn't have the energy I do, that I didn't have the opportunities I do, then it wouldn't happen. God is making that possible. So to remember that God supplies all our needs, he established what we call tithe paying. And from the earliest times in the Bible, you see that in the case of Jacob, in the case of Abraham, in the book of Genesis, how people paid tithe. Take, for instance, Jacob. Jacob was a man who deceived his brother, and because he deceived his brother regarding the inheritance, this brother, when he found out, he wanted to kill him. Not nice. And so his mother says, you better get out of here. So he runs away with just the clothes on his back. Jacob, the guy who comes from a family of wealthy patriarch like Isaac, I mean wealthy, he is running with just the clothes on his back. And at the end of that day of running, he's exhausted. He puts his head on a pillow, and he goes to sleep. And as he sleeps, God gives him a dream of angels going up and down the stairway right next to him, from heaven to him. And he senses that God is still with him in spite of the fact that he had cheated his brother, in spite of the fact that he really messed things up, and now he has nothing left. God would still be here. And so in the morning, when he gets up, he makes a promise to God. Of all you give me, I will surely give a tenth to you. In other words, I have nothing now, but I'm counting on you to supply my need. And I make a pledge. I will give you a tenth of everything you give me. Sure enough, 20 years later, Jacob is a rich man, goes back to his father's homeland as a rich man, because God kept his side of the bargain. In the case of Abraham, the same thing preceded, you know, his grandfather. Abraham gave tithe to Melchizedek, the high priest as well as the king. Blessed be Abram of God, most high, possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be God most high, who has delivered your enemies into your hand. And he gave him a tithe of all. That is, when Abraham chased after five kings, he took their spoil. All of a sudden, he was rich already. He was a lot richer. But he gave a percentage of that to the man of God as being faithful with the whole principle of tithe. Tithe means a tenth. And that's the, God actually limits you to give him only 10%. He actually limits you. He says tenth. I mean, it's very, very clear. One-tenth of your income. Proverbs 3:9 tells us that. Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of your increase. That's agrarian language. So whenever you have increase from where you are, the extra, then 10% of that. Today, if you get a check, it would be 10% of your check. So that is the tithe. But that is not all. Because God, in his great wisdom, has given us a chance to go beyond that tithe and go that in what we call offerings. This is what Jesus says, Luke 6:38. Give, I like this. Give and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Now let's visualize this. It's like somebody giving you grain in this container. Good measure. In other words, it's not no cheating the scales. Good measure. Press down, so you push it down so you can fit more grain on it, right? Press down and then shaken together so every little hole is filled with the grain and then running over. That's God's desire. That's his promise. He says, you're going to be faithful. I'm going to really give it back to you. That is what he says. Leviticus 27 says that tithe is holy to the Lord. There are few things that are holy in the Bible. A tithe is one of them. Tithe is dedicated specifically for the preaching of the gospel. The preaching of the gospel. My salary, it comes from an institution. I teach for a university. But my salary, because I'm a gospel worker, I teach the Bible and I preach the Bible, comes from tithe. Comes from tithe. Offerings, however, is the other equation of it. Offerings are given according to the blessing we receive. Offering is, that's when we can really get creative and excited. A lot of Christians that I know give tithe faithfully for years, and then they give $5 every once in a while for their offering. That is a misunderstanding of what offering is about. Offering is according to how much you're being blessed. And so if I give it, if God $5 every once in a while, I'm saying, God, you really, really, really are stingy with me. That's what I'm saying. I'm saying, you know, it's worth only $5. Well, $5 is the price of a magazine. Can you believe that? So, this is when I can get creative and I can really give him because I said, God, you really are good to me. I want to give back to you so much more than just the minimum. And that is why Deuteronomy says 16:17, every man shall give as he is able. This is the principle right here. According to the blessing of the Lord your God, which he has given you. So it's tithe and offerings. Look at Malachi 3:8. Shocking statement. Will a man rob God? Not even steal from God, but rob God, like in your face, holding you up, you know. Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. You say, in what have we robbed you? And God answers, in tithes and offerings. So when we give a good faithful tithe, we're just returning something to God. It's only 10%. But if we don't give offerings, we're still robbing God. Because we are saying, we're keeping to us a blessing. We're saying, you're not blessing. You're not blessing at all. But obviously, God is blessing. And so we're holding that back. He says in Malachi 3, verse 10, bring all the tithe into the storehouse, a central distributing location to be a blessing to others, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord host, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven. You remember that story about the shake it together and press down? Now he's talking about opening the windows of heaven and pour out for you such a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. Whoa. That is his promise. Here are some notable tithe payers in American history. We recognize their names. Colgate, Rockefeller Jr., Henry Hines, J.C. Penney, you know, John Wanamaker, James Craft, Milton Hershey, and others. A lot of these men were faithful Christians. They don't only gave 10%. They actually gave more like 80 and 90% of their income. Modern day Bill Gates, in Bill and Melinda Gates today in many ways. Don't you think that God is going to keep giving to those people because they give away? Absolutely. He says, I have found a venue where I can bless many other people. Then I'm going to pour that there so that they can distribute that as well. Verse 11 finally says, I will rebuke the devourer for your sake so that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground. Again, in an agrarian society, that was very important. Any pestilence, any plague, you don't want that because then your crops die. I will rebuke that devourer, nor shall the wine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. So that's his promise. He says, you're faithful in tithe and offerings. I will protect you. I will keep you. Your car will not break down as often. Your insurance will not go up as often. You will not have the collisions you used to have. All kinds of things. It's going to save you money. It's amazing what God can do when he is in your business. Here's the breakdown of the two concepts in the Bible. Tithe is based on percentage, only 10%. Offering is based on proportion, how much, you know, what proportion you want to give back. So you don't have to keep it to 10. You can do 20%, you can do 5%, however you feel you are blessed. Whereas tithe is based on the increase, a very specific mathematical formula. The tithe is for the gospel worker, whereas the offerings are for gospel work, for mission, and for church work to bless other people. The question is, who will be first in my life? Who will be first in my life? Is it my things, my possessions, because I think I own them? Matthew 6:33 says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be what? Added unto you. And he's been talking, if you read that chapter, he's been talking about shelter and food and everything you need. He says, I provide that to the birds of the field. I provide it to the flowers. How much more valuable are you than they, he says. I will provide for you. So what Jesus is saying is, give and it shall be given unto you. That's simple. Give and it shall be given unto you. Psalm 37 verse 25 says, I have been young and now I am old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. I have seen the faithfulness of God time and time again. Philippians 4:19, my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. I know that some of you are thinking, if I keep the Sabbath, I might have to leave my job. If I leave my job, I don't have that source of income. And who knows what kind of a job I'm going to get. Maybe it's going to be less income than before. Leave those questions to God. I just want to encourage you to trust what he says. Take him to task. Take him to task. You can read it back to him, actually, to pray. And you say, look, you say that. It's right here. Philippians 4:19. That would not be sacrilege. That would not be preposterous. That is an act of faith. This is what you say, Lord. Because of that, I am going to trust you. I am going to quit my job. I'm going to ask permission. If they don't give it to me, I'm going to quit my job. I said, I have now been enlightened. He says, well, you didn't need that day off before. Yes, but I wasn't totally surrendered to what the Bible taught before either. And now I am. So I am going to be faithful to God. And you see how God will provide. It's all a matter of trust. Everything about Jesus is a matter of whether we trust his word or not. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Let me close with this story. In Washington State, Mr. Weiss Miller had a potato farm. There's a number of potato farms out there in Washington, Idaho, and all those places in the Northwest. And he was a faithful tithe payer and a faithful Sabbath keeper. It was a Friday afternoon when he was strolling about. He was waiting for sundown. He had gotten everything ready. He was prepared several hours before sundown. And he was taking a walk. He decided to go and see some of his crops, take a walk. But to his horror, he finds that all the plants are full of these bugs, these weevils, that are he recognizes them and says, these critters are going to eat my entire crops in a matter of hours. All of them, millions of them. So what would you normally do? Normally, you would immediately try to get those pesticides or call for help and really get busy to take care of that. But that's not what he did. He went back to his room, to his home. He went back and looked at his tithe receipts and whether he had been faithful to God in what he said. Then he opened it to Malachi 3. He read Malachi 3 and he said, Lord, you said you will rebuke the devourer because I have been faithful to you. And I don't want to worry about this on Sabbath because it's your day. So I'm checking out. You take care of my crops. This is your field. This is your land. So if you want these crops to die and me have nothing, it's up to you. It all belongs to you. And so he checked out so he wouldn't worry about it as much. Came back early on Sunday morning to see, you know, what was left, if anything. To his astonishment, he finds that there is, all the plants were nice and healthy, and all the bugs were dead. They were dead. And so he walks and he walks and he finds that they're dead. He's astonished. He's moved to tears about that. And then he says, God, I wish you would tell me how you did this. How did you do this? And it, no sooner was the expression out of his mouth that he looks down at his boots and he finds that he's next to a plant that this ugly-looking thing burrows its way out of the ground, goes up the stem. Oh, by the way, there were two who were still alive right there. The only two he had found alive on the leaf. So this critter goes up the stem, chooses the right leaf, goes to the two that are alive, stings one, stings the other one, and goes right back down to the earth. That's a true story. God will be faithful. God will do it. Give, and it shall be given to you. Give of your time. Give of your talent. Give of your treasure. It all belongs to him anyway. But when you do that out of your heart, God is delighted, and he takes over your life and your affairs. That is what a Christian lives like. I want to give you a chance to respond to this. And so please take your response card. Some of you I know have been thinking about keeping the Sabbath. Some of you have been thinking about accepting some of the other biblical teachings that you've been exposed to. Some of you have been thinking about baptism or rebaptism, or joining the church by profession of faith. Please indicate that there. And turn that into your rojos or to your leaders in your satellite sites. Trust God, trust God, trust God, trust God. In everything he says, trust God. If you weren't ready for this, you wouldn't be listening to it right now. God knows that you're ready. That's why you're being exposed to what you're being exposed to today. Let's listen to Lizbeth as she sings and as you fill that out tonight. Than Let's pray together. Father in heaven, I'd rather have Jesus than anything else, because everything else will come with Jesus. Lord, thank you for the privilege we have to be stewards of time, talent, and treasure. Help us be faithful in the administration of the things you've given to us for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Yeah.